So thank you, Yannis, for agreeing to talk with me in your office. We've had a few, one meeting really before, where we've had the opportunity to talk. And so it's really nice for me to get deeper insight into some of your personal motivations around your research and your teaching. And then also to share that and connect that with scholars that we know and students that we engage with. So I wanted to start off by asking you, what was it that initially drew you to the subject of the environment?
Well, if I'm to go really far back to my childhood, I think the most important thing is that I was raised in Athens, an extremely polluted city. So I was able to notice the issue that, yes, I was in the big city, I was showing off to people from the countryside, but it was extremely polluted at the same time, and it was obvious. So the smoke of Athens was notorious. Everybody in Europe was talking at the time about that. They were very concerned about it. They even were allowing only certain cars to enter the center of Athens. It was based on the number plates. Odds and even numbers. So this is a day for odd numbers only to come, the other is even numbers. So we have this kind of issues from a young age coming. I was able to notice that it was, first of all, I was going to the Greek countryside, I was able to notice the difference, but I was also able to notice the total indifference of the people. There was so much littering, for example, the countryside. And that was fairly obvious for a young child to see these, you know, plastic bags hanging from trees. There was something that was hitting the imagination. The other one was, my mother was from the island of Zante, and there was an issue about protecting the careta. It was like sea turtles, loggerheads. They were breeding in a particular beach area that was started developing for tourist purposes. Okay, so that was another thing that was hitting me, that was to protect the turtles, you know, of the Zante, you know, that was a big issue that as a child was hitting me. So from that it developed later, when I was a teenager, I was involved in various citizen initiatives, dealing with local environmental issues. And then later that stimulated me undertaking these issues in my university studies. So, for instance, I did my undergraduate dissertation on a related issue in Mexico. Then, I did a master's in environmental social sciences. My PhD again on environmental issues. I compare Greece and Spain over this issue. And then later, when I was employed at Queen's University, I developed a module on environmental sociology. Then I moved on to green criminology, and the latest incarnation of the same module is environmental crime and justice, it's called nowadays. So these were the main issues in terms of how I developed my the environmental issues, but very more specific. I'll talk about the environmental sustainability. Environmental sustainability, I first came in contact with this term when I did my master's in environmental social sciences. But then that term is incorporated in all the other modules that I developed, in every single one of them. I have to ask also, my research is very much linked to environmental sustainability. In particular, I started researching the environmental impact of organizing sport mega events, say Olympics. So what I found out was the International Olympic Committee demands for prospective host nations to factor in the environmental issue, in particular environmental sustainability, in their application to host the games. So from that I developed a research that actually it's at the center of my research interest for the past, I think I will say, 10 years. I'm researching the environmental impact of sport mega events, in particular the Olympic Games and the FIFA World Cup. Okay. And that's very important because nobody thinks about that. But I mean, these are events that involve many different countries. Many people move to attend this host, this festival, different parts of the world. So in terms of carbon impact, it's immense. You have all these movements, and you have developments of different projects, again, costly for the environment. In particular, if you take into account not the Summer Olympic Games, because the Summer Olympics are in the urban environment. So we must think about the impact on the city. The Winter Olympics are in the mountain. So they have more, I can appreciate that they have a more immense impact to the natural environment. So all of this creates a conflict situation. And from that, it's really important to see, to examine that, bring so many different variables in terms of social science. You have to think about the population. What is the environmental sensitivity of the local population, for example? So there is an examination on that. Then protest. Are there special environmental groups likely to protest about the adverse, the negative impact of the games? And then you have on the other hand the national pride issue. Mm. So for instance, when Athens was to host the 2004 Olympics, there was an immense issue of national pride. So the people who were saying there's going to be that negative impact on the environment were not the most important, but downgraded these concerns, because it was such an immense issue of national pride. You know, we were the country of origin of the Olympic Games, so we have it back now, and that's an immense. So you have all these kind of nationalistic, patriotic discourses that were coming. Okay, so this kind of negative environmental impact didn't feature, didn't hold much. The same you can say for the latest Summer Olympics in Rio de Janeiro. Again, there was an immense moment of pride for Rio to host the games. And that's very important because Brazil was the country that stimulated a lot of the environmental concern during the 1970s. So we were thinking of the 1970s, what's going to happen to the Amazon rainforest? That was the rallying cry in the developed world. Whereas in the Brazil, they were thinking, well, listen, you have destroyed your natural environment to develop. I mean, we should pollute as well in order to develop. Now, that was the issue, the contradiction that was coming. Then the 92, we have, again, in Rio, we have the conference on planet conference that was organized by the United Nations. And that's where the sustainable development concept emerged. In 92, in the conference on the wealth of the planet. Okay. And now, if I go again to Brazil, they have elected a maniac as a president, Bolsonaro, who's happy to bring industries to exploit the Amazon rainforest. So we have this circle coming from that, from the start of environmental concern globally. Again, Brazil was the key point. Then 92 have the emergence of the concept of sustainable development. It's very popular. You have even corporations like Greenpeace making a claim about the sustainability credentials. You have companies, you know, airway companies making a claim about the sustainability impact. Especially over the fact that they are so costly, the environment, flying around the world. So you have this kind of issues. So in terms of the other issue, what's important for engagement at university? Environmental sustainability is a very attractive concept. It can bring together many different sub-disciplines to work together to develop courses. You may even develop in terms of faculties. So in this faculty that we have now, you can develop with the courses available in this the faculty that we develop. You can also transverse, move to the other faculties, incorporate topics from the natural sciences. So, I mean, that's why it's very, very attractive. You have developed so many different pathways.
Yeah. I mean, the Sustainable Development Goals, higher education is meant to be a driver, key driver of the Sustainable Development Goals. And I think it's really interesting for somebody like me who has come through them from another angle to talk to someone who is steeped in the idea of environmental sustainability, about the value of it. Why do you think it's important as an issue to be discussed in higher education or in education now?
Yeah, I mean, it's very important to discuss this issue. It's one of the most important issues in the world right now. It's the most valence issue that everybody in general should be, have some kind of understanding and involvement in that. That's mostly in general. In particular, education is very much linked to what I said earlier about the capacity to involve so many different disciplines. Mm-hmm. But the other thing, when I specify, it's very good that you talk about sustainable development, because I single out environmental sustainability. The reason that I did that is was because of my interest in the Olympic Games, in my research. I liaised with people from the Wageningen University in Holland, and they have done work on in China. And I was interested to discuss the Beijing Olympics. And as you can appreciate, at the time it was evident that the Beijing Olympics that they organized at the time, they would struggle to cater for the immense pollution that was obvious in China. Why they have so much pollution is because we have sent all the polluting industries to produce in China. That was the one thing. So they have pollution because producing goods that we are consuming. If you go to the high street, most of the clothes you will see it's made in China, made in Pakistan. I can countries that have lower environmental standards in terms of sustainable development, and also lower workers, labor rights. So that's why they are so attractive. They create cheap products for us. So we are responsible as well. So that's another issue, that if you are dealing with sustainable development or environmental sustainability, you bring the most important dimensions in social sciences. Are we talking about structures or individuals? So you have the structures, the big capitalism and so on, and you can find the response, how responsible is that, how it's moving towards that direction. You also have to talk about individual responsibility. So you bring this issue as well. So by dealing with this environmental sustainability in education or any other discipline, you are immediately confront your student audience to examine their own personal responsibility. Mm. As you can appreciate, it creates an important and interesting topic to discuss. There's no boredom in the class. Okay, so many issues.
And I guess what's also important is, I mean, you're hopefully inculcating the possibility of future change.
Yeah.
Or an awareness of the limitations of that on an individual level.
Yeah.
I mean, I think one of the interesting things at the moment, and you alluded to it in Brazil, is that there's a push-pull happening at the moment between political will to engage with sustainable development and the idea of the environment as a common good that we're all meant to share. And then, I guess, political movements and economic interests, which are fighting against that progressive move that at least was happening on paper in some parts of the world.
Yeah. That's right, and that's why there was so much sensitivity about the election of Bolsonaro in Brazil. And that Bolsonaro, you can think in terms of another country in the continent. I'm talking about the United States and Trump.
Mm.
You can't think about Bolsonaro without thinking of his counterpart in the United States, such a powerful country. And the thing is, Trump has been openly a skeptic of climate change, or as you say, human-induced climate change. You know what happens? People who think like that, they don't think that this humanity is responsible for climate change. They present this issue as a cyclical, natural phenomenon. They refuse to accept that it's humans, in particular, the industrial developments that are causing
this. So I guess that's where it becomes so interesting and important to debate the idea of responsibility,
mm-hmm.
if there is going to be any environmental
change
or improvements.
There are so many things. I mean, you can think as well of the most important thing is our carbon dependency. I mean, we need carbon and we are dependent on carbon, and with that there are so many people employed in the carbon industry. So you are in a situation where there are fewer and fewer jobs, there's so much unemployment. Politicians are very sensitive about that.
Mm.
You know, by decarbonizing, they may reduce the ability to be re-elected.
Their popularity.
Their popularity, exactly.
The short-term gains versus the long-term gains, absolutely.
Mm.
Going
back to what I was saying about my engagement with people, scientists from Holland in relation to China, we're talking about sustainable development, and then we came to the, if you have to examine China, and in relation to the Beijing Olympics and the environmental Olympics, we should discuss it in sustainability by putting the environment as well, environmental sustainability. In other words, to avoid discussing the human rights issues. Because if you want to discuss sustainable development, we have to discuss about, you know, the suppression of the Uyghur minority, Muslim minority in China, and so many issues. So we said, okay, we just discussed the environmental impact. So we said environmental sustainability. Another kind of discussion with the same concept, they include these other human rights. But for that particular case, we decided to say, okay, we just focus on the environment.
Let's work with what we can do.
Yeah.
So,
I mean, that's why in my book, actually, I made the claim that actually China is doing really well in terms of environmental sustainability. And I mean, in fact, they did, actually. They produced another five-year plan. That's why the current communist regimes have five-year plans. And the next five-year plan after the Olympics was very much linked to environmental issues. They were making claims and have strategies for reducing CO2 emissions and so on and so forth. So it just ticked all the boxes.
Mm.
So it gives you the idea that that China will progressively change. It's a slower. I mean, they're trying to avoid the collapse of the communist regime, like what happened with Perestroika, say, in Russia. They're just taking a much slow. It's a slow process starting in the 1970s with the Gen Z outpaying the first like change from the Maoist. So we have to go back to that actually to examine all these things, the whole history going from there.
Right. So grappling with these issues gives, particularly your approach, gives a much larger sense of the social context as well as the historic context in which this comes, these changes come or are situated, in addition to the tensions and the weighing up of different costs or capital that can happen at the same time.
Yeah, and as you appreciate, this can become, in terms of teaching courses, bringing these issues in particular courses can really engage the students. And then actually, it's not about just stagnant kind of teaching. It's research intensive, where the students are participating in research, particular modules that incorporate that environmental sustainability. So that was what I attracted to.
Sure. What, in terms of your own research, I mean, you've been working in this for a considerable length of time.
Mm-hmm.
What gaps or areas of research do you foresee or things that still perplex you going forward?
Well, I think we can. There are so many chances on, if you are to continue the same level and start talking about the following the IPCC report, the Intergovernmental Panel on Climate Change, the latest report, where they were making a big claim that it's absolute necessity to move away from carbon and avoid increasing the global temperatures more than from 2 degrees that was in the earlier report, they move it to 1.5. We cannot increase more than 1.5 degrees Celsius. That's a big claim they made. So with that in mind, my biggest challenge will be how to assess society's capacity to move to decarbonize, to decarbonize societies. So it's fascinating what's happening to in Ireland, for example. They have already started the process to decarbonize in the Republic. What stimulated the society? What they have to decarbonize, and the United Kingdom doesn't, for example. Or if I go to my native Greece, will they decarbonize? I mean, we are so much they need. Carbon, because it offers cheap electricity. So Greece is that situation. In other countries on the same level, inside Europe, peripheral European countries, perhaps they have the same challenge. So again, so many variables, so many areas of research, only for that issue, decarbonization. And can you, you know, it's immense comparative study.
Well, thank you very much.
All right.
It's been really interesting speaking to
you. Yeah, I can talk for ages.
And getting a glimpse as to what it has inspired you and kept you sustaining this topic. Thank you very much.
Thank you.